You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Restorative Justice, Intercultural Conflict Resolution, and Peacebuilding. Once again, I'm very happy to have a guest on our show today. But before I introduce him, I, as usual, would like to spend a few minutes with a PowerPoint. Before we go to that PowerPoint, let me briefly introduce the focus of our broadcast today. Last week, we had a Jewish American alumni start to talk about his time in Israel, his perspective, having studied negotiation, conflict resolution, and peacebuilding regarding the Palestinian and Israeli conflict. It was a rich discussion. I'm happy that several of you were able to join us. This week, I'm very happy to actually have an Arab Muslim alumni of our program. And sadly, he's from Syria, not because it's the cradle of ancient civilization, but because, as most of you know, for the last 6 years, it's been locked in a tragic war. And there are so many Syrian refugees struggling around the world. So this week, I would like to explore some of his experience in Southern California and some of his perspective on the Syrian crisis. I would now like to turn to my PowerPoint to introduce a little bit more of how NCRP is of interest within the Middle East and within Muslim communities around the world. Let's turn to my PowerPoint. Now, as I reflected on our students over the 13 years that I've been teaching in negotiation, conflict resolution, and peacebuilding at Dominguez Hills, and actually my 5 years as a lecturer at UC Berkeley, where I taught Afghani refugees of war, and had a very diverse classroom. You can imagine any of you who've been to UC Berkeley. Arab students of conflict resolution and peacebuilding are actually one of the groups that's most interested in our program, at least during my time teaching it. And I have had students from Egypt, Lebanon, Jordan, Morocco, Syria, and Turkey over the years. Actually, maybe one of our students from Turkey is currently tuning in. I have also had many Muslim students, as well as I was just explaining to our guest, devoted Christians, particularly devoted Christians within the African American community. It's wonderful to see who's drawn to peace building. Now, some Americans, we should be embarrassed to say this, confuse Muslim and Arab. We are not educated enough about the world to understand some of the differences. I'd like to mention that early on in Southern California history, the majority of Arab students, or at least Arabs living in Orange County, were Christian Arabs. You cannot assume all Arabs are Muslim. And the same with Lebanese. Some of our early students of NCRP, we have one right now working with Eric Garcetti in the City of LA Human Relations Office. She is Lebanese Christian. And Egypt is a similar mix. These are multicultural, multi-faith communities. Just like we are not a Christian nation state, despite some Americans wanting to say we're a Christian nation state. We separate church and state. These countries also have their minority faiths and minority communities. Now, the majority of Muslims in Southern California, last time I looked, are from one of the countries with the most Muslims in the world, India. And the third largest group, very interesting, is our African Americans in Southern California. I did not, I'm embarrassed to say, know that there were two Gandhis until I was teaching my culture of peace course at Bethlehem Bible College on the West Bank, and one of my students, an Arab Muslim from the West Bank, introduced me to Frontier Gandhi. If you know the history of India's independence, you will know that Gandhi rallied for nonviolent resistance. Well, Frontier Gandhi was his Muslim counterpart, and he also rallied for nonviolence, and he was against partition. He believed in multicultural, multi-faith nation states. Now, I've mentioned already Lebanon is one example of a multi-faith country in the Middle East. Last I looked, and this research, you know, is not always current, but last I looked, 54% of Lebanon identifies themselves as Muslim, 40% Christian. Now, my Muslim students of NCRP don't necessarily come from the Middle East. My first war refugees were Afghani. We have been at war in Afghanistan off and on forever. And I've also had students who fled Iran during the revolution, the ousting, you know, of the monarchy. I don't know how many of you are going to know the histories of these countries. You need to become familiar and educate yourself, given our global community in the world today. I've also had many Muslim students from Pakistan. So we have a wide-ranging group. Now, I want to briefly, before I introduce Manny, I want to introduce some of the interests of these Arab or Muslim students of mine. Now, my Afghani youth at UC Berkeley and also my Persian youth from Iran were very much interested in cross-generational conflict. Their families were recent immigrants to the U.S., and their parents and grandparents tended to be more traditional, while the young people were trying to become more modern and contemporary. And particularly, conflict involving young girls was often the subject of their cross-generational conflict. Now, when I have taught refugees of war, and I've also had students who are refugees of the horrific Cambodian, what I would call genocide. I've had many Vietnamese students who are the children of the boat people who fled Vietnam. And they are oftentimes, like Caitlin described a few weeks ago, the intercultural mediators, helping their parents, their grandparents learn U.S. culture, the cultures. They might be the first who are fluent in English and able to bridge cultural difference. That's a very common role. Now, these are all reasons for studying negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building. And we welcome all the different reasons that students come into our program. Now, I have not mentioned, and frankly, I don't know if I asked the religion of some of my Balkan students, but I've also had students attracted to NCRP because of the horrific war that they suffered. Now, the Middle East, most of you noticed during the Arab Spring, which started in Egypt and was a grassroots, nonviolent movement to oust the dictators of the Middle East. Sadly, too much of the world, if you know what's going on in their country, still suffers under the hands of ruthless, selfish dictators. But sadly, at least in Egypt, I'm not an expert on any of these countries, but I did have Egyptian students during the Arab Spring, and I've engaged in other countries about what was going on in Egypt. most of the citizens were not prepared for democracy after ousting their dictator. And given what happened in Egypt with the military siding with the grassroots movement, the ground was pretty much laid for what has been happening in Egypt. What I would like to emphasize here is one of my Egyptian alumni has gone back to her home country, taking her negotiation and conflict resolution skills and promoting them to the government there as essential life skills. I would see them as actually skills for democracy building. Now I have a Muslim student from Lebanon, and you know these the interests and the contributions post-graduation are going to vary depending on the country, depending on faith, community, all of it. He returned to Lebanon with Jimmy Carter and his group to oversee elections in Lebanon to ensure they were democratic rather than corrupt. And this is significant progress. I have been working with a student from Cameroon, for example, for the last 20 years because there he has not, despite his peace work with the Ecumenical Service for Peace, and his mediation mastery, he has not been able to organize the community and raise the funds to monitor the elections in his country so that they're democratic and fair, free of corruption. I mentioned already Jamana, who works with Eric Garcetti. She works actively throughout Los Angeles with community dialogue. So you may even meet her if you're actively involved with police community dialogue, homeowners and homeless dialogue. That's the work she's devoted herself to. Now I have a Muslim student from Jordan who simply studied NCRP to do what many of our students do, learn alternative dispute resolution, arbitration, mediation, win-win negotiation as an alternative to a legal system that is, now I have never studied the Jordanian legal system, so I don't know if it's overwhelmed with legal cases like some countries, the US and India, for example, or if it's not necessarily an inclusive, fair, just system. Perhaps people with more money are able to get better justice than those who are suffering with less. I don't know. But I do know that he was very excited, and I think he has gone on to law school because he wants to introduce culture. His cultures actually have traditional and indigenous dispute resolution mechanisms, but he's really enthused about growing a business and introducing more contemporary global methods of dispute resolution. Now, my Pakistani student who grew up in Carson, California, where we are broadcasting today. Now I have other Pakistani colleagues and friends, but this is a rare story. Her parents actually, who are Muslim, hosted interfaith salons in their homes the entire time that Amber was growing up in Carson. So she, in my vision of her family and experience, was growing up with the best of negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building as a child. She currently mentors troubled youth, and I think she's in the valley doing that. We have a lot of troubled youth throughout Southern California, and she is helping to, in some ways, reparent them so they have a chance for a decent day-to-day living. You can see that we have quite a bit of diversity in our students and their interests. Now, our guest today, who I'll be introducing shortly, is from Syria. He has lived in this country for many years, and you will hear his story in detail. But certainly, I expect to have some students who are the children of Syrian refugees. We are not accepting, California is accepting more Syrian refugees than any other state in the United States. But compared to Middle Eastern countries and compared to Sweden and Germany, Canada, we are accepting very, very few. But I expect that will start to be part of NCRP. For those of you who don't know, our distance program actually broadcasts around the world. So my students do not need to be living in Southern California to be part of our distance master's program. It's a very rich international pool. I've already mentioned that I have had students who are war refugees from Cambodia and Vietnam. And given I teach peace building, it is absolutely important that we start to talk about the real experience of war. Now, I'm going to share about my own family, the German-speaking immigrants to this country who came during the 1800s. Did so as young men to avoid being conscripted into the endless, eternal European wars. You know, the religions, unfortunately, centered in Jerusalem, the Abrahamic faith, just seemed to have this as a long-term tradition history. And many immigrants came to this country to avoid this endless fighting, as well as its tragic cost. We don't seem to be learning. Instead, in my opinion, as a professor of peace building, we continue to allow politicians and the industrial military complex to manipulate us and make money on the backs of many of our young people, and, you know, at the tragic cost of people around the world. So hearing the stories of victims of war is incredibly important. I had a Cambodian student, for example, who was 6 years old when he grew up during the violence in Cambodia. And when he spoke of his childhood memories, the whole class, you know, you could hear a pin drop. They were so moved. We need to be doing this on a regular basis. Simply as an American who protested the what I see as illegal invasion of Iraq based on deceit and lies, who believes that what we've been attempting to do in Afghanistan is impossible, as all these wars have shown, and as somebody who tried to stop some of our young people from enlisting in our military branches, because I know that most 17 and 18 years olds, particularly those who have grown up poor, grown up working class, and don't know how they're going to pay for increasingly expensive education, they have no idea what they are signing up for. And as I talk to returning vets in my classrooms, they agree with me. They were used, fooled, exploited. As my husband, who is a retired colonel, says, if the politicians themselves are not sending their children to fight in a war, there is something to be questioned. And so now we have many traumatized and injured vets, as well as the victims of war. The horrible pictures you've seen of the children and the families of Syria, at least our media has been showing us some of the realities. So before I introduce our guests, I want to ask, because this is a class and a show on restorative justice as well as intercultural conflict resolution, who are the offenders in war? And what should we require from those who profit, gain materially, politically, in power from war? I would say, when it comes to war and peace, that the introduction of the International Criminal Court is absolutely essential. And as a former litigator, I'm not anti-rule of law. I'm pro-just enforcement of law, and I'm disturbed that the United States has not been willing to support the International Criminal Court, because I do not know of anyone who is responsible for a horrific war who is willing to take responsibility for harm done and do anything to repair. We need to use the retributive justice system to its full extent. Now, you know, World War II, the genocide, the Holocaust of World War II is when we had the Geneva Convention, when human rights were created, when the U.S. experienced the horrific cost, destruction of war. And I thought that people had learned their lesson, at least in the United States. That's what I thought. But then I got to experience the relentless Vietnam War and how the U.S. continues to either promote war or in various ways lengthen war and profit from war. It deeply disturbs me. Now, sometimes the victims of war or other international crimes, such as the victims of apartheid in South Africa, they want information and they are willing to agree to a controversial truth and reconciliation commissions which grant amnesty to the offenders, meaning the offenders do not need to take responsibility for harm done. They do not need, we don't go forward with either retributive or restorative justice. And then, of course, there are the questions that seem nearly impossible to answer. How do you repair the harm done in war? Can victims ever be made whole? Now, I am starting to become more familiar with the Syrian refugee crisis. I met some of the recent refugees in Ireland a couple of years back. Some of my students from Sweden and Germany and Italy are letting me know some of the other struggles that are going on. It's really tough. Now, welcoming Syrian refugees and other refugees of war to Southern California is definitely one way of starting to repair harm, giving them a safe place to heal and start to build the lives they deserve and need. Is a very powerful way of starting to repair some of the harm. Now, Sacramento is the hub for Afghani refugees in Southern California. It's part of why I was teaching them at UC Berkeley. But less than 20,000 have been welcomed in the last 20 years. Now, I'm not going to take the time to give you other numbers of who else we have welcomed to this country, but I was shocked a few years ago when I was at a U.S. citizenship ceremony to discover that immigrants from the Philippines and from Central America were topping the list. Many, many more have been welcomed than this 20,000. Now, if they are refugees of war or if they are veterans of war, they are suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. Those who are new to this country need help understanding and navigating the culture. Healing from any kind of post-traumatic stress disorder requires concentrated and extended resources over time. Now, the Vets Administration gives this to our vets, our traumatized, injured vets. But, you know, I've looked around a bit in Southern California. I know some of the agencies that provide this counseling and help. But we need to really be conscious of the need to do this to move forward. Now, I don't know if you know, but Long Beach has more Cambodian residents than any other place but Cambodia. Long Beach is referred to as Little Cambodia. Now, I did not know that Orange County also has Little Arabia, I guess that's what it said. I'll get there in a minute, but we all know about Westminster being Little Vietnam. An estimated 182,000 refugees of the Vietnam War. Now, I don't know if that research is actually Orange County or the U.S., sorry. But you see, there are many, many more who were welcomed to the United States. Yeah, Little Arabia. I haven't been. I look forward to it. I've been to Little India in Artesia, but I need to go to Anaheim and Garden Grove because I must say, spending time in the Middle East, I have developed quite a taste and hunger for my favorite Middle Eastern foods, and I have a feeling I would be able to enjoy that there. I also enjoy some of the music quite a bit. I earlier told you we've welcomed more Syrian refugees to California than any other state in the United States, but last I looked, we've only welcomed about 1,500. Such a small number. As I was doing this research, many questions were arising. Why? What's going on here? Now, some of it, my questions are answered, you know, with our ugly politics and the daily media. But just to give you some contrast, Canada has welcomed 25,000 and Sweden 100,000. Now, as someone who's growing up in severe winters and cold, my goodness, what a transition to go from Syria to the Middle East to Canada or Sweden. It's painful just to think of. Now, I happen to believe that we should be welcoming more here because I think they are more likely to learn to have intercultural relations in the U.S. Because of our public education system and because of our workplace, we do not have the benefits, the dole, as it's called in Ireland, of the EU. You know, sadly, because European Union refugees are given money to support themselves and their families, they don't necessarily need to learn the language. They don't need to relate to the Swedish people born and raised in Sweden. And there's a lot of problems we're seeing throughout the EU with segregated communities and very alienated, angry youth because they're not receiving the same opportunities to advance. Now, we have a lot of problems in our public education and our workplace too, but as you can imagine, I'm devoted to that teaching in NCRP. Okay, enough from me today. I would like to now introduce our guest. We're going to have a wonderful conversation. I'm hoping, as most weeks, that some of my students are watching. If you are, please call in or email in your questions so we can have conversation. Community members are also welcome to do that. And from what I've been told by our broadcasting studio, the information to do that should be provided as part of your channel, as part of your viewing. Okay, Manny, thank you for being here with me today.
Thank you for having
yes.
me.
And sorry, I'm going to embarrass you a bit, but it's your birthday today, and I feel honored, very happy that one of our alumni would be there on his birthday.
Yeah,
which
I can't think of a better way to celebrate.
Yes, thank you very much. You're very gracious.
Just,
you know,
completed my 48th revolution around the sun today.
Yes, congratulations. Warm wishes for many more.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, we've had a bit of a conversation over the years because you are an alumni of our program, NCRP, and I normally start there because once we start to talk about Syria, your experience, you know, as a Muslim Arab, that's a fair, accurate description, who has worked and lived in Southern California for many years. We're not going to get back to NCRP, I don't think. So let's start. You graduated from our program recently, a couple years back?
It's just last May.
Okay, 1 year
tell you
back,
a little
yes.
bit my background.
Yes, please.
I'm an entrepreneur, real estate broker. I own and manage a boutique brokerage in Orange County. Been in the America since about 23 years ago.
Wow, a long time. Have you always been in California?
No, actually, I moved to Southern California in the year 2000.
Okay.
Before that, I worked for a Fortune 500 company in Houston, Texas, in the travel business for a few years.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And I speak Arabic and French.
Nice.
In fact, I have a bachelor degree in French literature from Damascus University.
Thank you. I was just going to ask how you learned French. That's wonderful. Yeah,
and I graduated from the Graduate School of Business at Pepperdine University.
Very good. I have colleagues, friends over there in the MBA program.
In the BSM program.
Okay, yes. No, it's a world-renowned program.
I taught
in the law school, Strauss Institute for Dispute Resolution.
And just last May, I graduated with a master's from Cal State Dominguez Hills, NCRP.
Right.
And
well, tell us, since you have a rich education, really, I can imagine you were doing very well without us, but what attracted you to our program?
See, the crisis in Syria took a toll on all Syrians, and Syrians in the diaspora are no exception.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
The conflict in Syria redirected my ambition from advancing in business management to an education where I can possibly contribute in helping people affected by the war.
Oh, okay.
And that was the reason. It wasn't planned whatsoever, and I knew very little about the program before the crisis. So things happen in life, I guess.
Yes, I believe that, yes.
That can reshape or redirect your path, and this is one of them.
Wow, yeah.
And again, just like any immigrant, I moved to the U.S., to America, seeking an opportunity and better life.
Economic opportunity is often...
All opportunities of all sorts. And
okay. We'll go there. I will come back to the opportunities you see in the United States, because the last few years, it's become a country that scares me, shocks me, but at the same time, I'm very glad I was born here and I am an American and I live here, so we'll go there. But you came to NCRP, so you already felt pretty comfortable with business negotiations, real estate negotiations, all of that, because sometimes people do, in real estate, they will come to learn, like I mentioned with my student from Jordan, to learn arbitration, to learn negotiation. Your passion, your interest was the peace building piece. Yes.
That is so true, because negotiation is something I do day in and day out. I represent buyers.
Yes, of course you do, yes.
I represent buyers, sellers, investors in the acquisition or disposition of their properties, and that's the negotiation part that I do all the time.
The distributive dance is what you do in real estate, right? Distributive bargaining? Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
It is the best description. And I was born and raised in Damascus, the oldest inhabitant city, where trade is what people are known for since the beginning of time. So
yes.
Negotiation is kind of like an acquired
part
skill.
Part of the culture,
by default. So
yeah, that's true.
But honestly, I knew very little about conflict resolution before joining the program. And peace building is something also that was newly introduced to, although I lived in a country where it is in the midst of all conflicts in the world, I think the Middle East. So I witnessed all kind of peace building endeavors. Maybe it wasn't the best experiences back then.
But you saw people trying. And when you studied the material, this is very common among our students. They start to go, oh, that's exactly what I saw someone attempting to do. And that is part of, peace studies as a discipline is relatively new. and actual peace building where you learn these skills to build peace and create a culture of peace. Most people hear it and look at me like, where is this coming from? They've never even heard it. But before we talk about the peace building piece a bit more, did you learn anything in your negotiation tactics course? I'm just curious because you are a successful real estate broker.
Absolutely, I learned a lot. At least I learned to put names to faces. I knew the practices, but I didn't know the theories.
Yes, so exactly.
I put the puzzle together, and now I can envision the picture holistically rather than just knowing that this way will work better than this
right,
way.
Right, right. You can explain it to people. Yeah, you can give theories.
At least I can explain it to myself. I mean, why this is happening, because there's a theory behind this tactic or this way of doing negotiation.
Yes. Absolutely.
So I definitely learned a lot from the negotiation part.
Okay, very good then.
And a lot more on the other side of conflict resolution and peace building.
Okay, now I don't know whether to start. None of us, unless there's other Syrians that are going to be watching this at some point, most of us at least have never had a chance to visit Syria, and it feels very sad to me. Because I love visiting the countries where I get a sense of ancient civilization. I really love that. You know, for example, when I went to Jerusalem, when I went to the West Bank, when I go to India, you know, pick the country, I can just feel the history and appreciate it. And so much of that has been at least what I would appreciate in terms of buildings and structures and beauty has been destroyed with this horrible war. But would you like to start with telling us a bit of what your life was like in Syria before you came here? And then we can talk about some of your thoughts now that you have graduated from NCRP with what people were attempting to do to build, create peace. Do you want to start there, or should we start with your experience in the U.S.?
Yes.
They're both big topics,
So Syria is a beautiful country and rich in history and good people.
Yes.
But opportunity is limited because of corruption, and it's the sad truth for most third world countries.
Yeah.
And
tell our viewers a little bit more about the corruption. You might assume they know what you're talking about, but unless they've worked with it or seen it, they may not understand. Where is this corruption?
So the wealth is in the hand of a few. How the regime in Damascus, who's been in power for 50 years, so they got control of all aspects of the government or the state
power.
Of power.
Yes, including the courts and everything.
And
the wealthy are able to manipulate the system, control it.
Absolutely true. So it is. The corruption is at all levels, and that's why people had enough of all oppression, and they wanted to do something else in 2011, and the uprising erupted.
But the corruption, when I was in India last, I met some of the corrupt government people, and some are quite proud of themselves. They think, you know, this is a way of life. You grease the palm in order to get a government service. You need to pay a bribe. I also met very strong lawyers and Supreme Court judges who are intense, since that is a democracy. Scary right now, some of the nationalism going on, but it's still a multicultural, multi-faith democracy, who were attempting to take on the corruption. Actually, the youth of India were rallying in masses, saying, if we don't clean up this corruption, we are not going to have the future we deserve. Was it a similar situation in Syria? To get any government service, you had to pay someone extra, or you simply didn't get served? How would you describe it?
This is, I think, it's universal in third world countries, again, to have this level of corruption to bribing is kind of like...
Oh, it's very prevalent, yes.
It's really natural, and it's not, there's nothing wrong with that. In countries like Syria, I can speak, I don't know much about India, but I'm thinking it is the same. And yes, corruption is at all levels, and that's again the main reason why people wanted to change and wanted saw just like you mentioned earlier in the PowerPoint presentation,
yes.
Countries like Egypt and before that Libya and Tunisia before.
Yes. I didn't include the whole Arab Spring, but
yeah,
that's a show.
They thought the people of Syria thought that it will be a seamless transition, if you will. Maybe a little hostility, but not
yeah.
as
not at all what happened.
Not a fierce war that's going into the seventh year
yes.
the end of the seventh year. So it is really sad what happened. And
now, Manny, excuse me for interrupting, but the image you're giving me, and you know, I had a Fulbright Distinguished Chair in Brazil. A couple of years ago. I'm not going to name all the countries I consider some version of the global South, third world. But as an American, I am not willing to participate in the corruption that has been created by the wealthy elite that, you know, the average citizen of that country cannot confront, take on very easily. But one of the things that ADR has actually done for international global business is that international businessmen who are from countries where there are laws against corruption, and we could talk about the U.S. because I am aware of the corruption that goes on here as well, but they will create contracts with the business counterpart to protect themselves with informally created law, just in case somebody decides they're going to ask for extra money or do, you know, something corrupt. Now, that's the best of what American and European business people do. The worst is they look for a corrupt regime with no rule of law, and they're able to exploit the resources without a justice system protecting the people. And the image you've created of Syria, frankly, reminds me of this emerging global 1% that is attempting, under our current president, to amass the wealth and power for themselves. And corruption is laughable. You know, that's what we're currently... Is that a fair picture?
It is a fair picture, and the corruption in countries like Syria is touching all aspects of life. The way you described it in more advanced countries like the U.S. or other countries, it is kind of like limited to certain large contracts with big corporations, not as much as comparable as corruption in Syria, for instance.
Right, day-to-day living.
Yeah, like the smallest thing, you have to work your ways around it. And this is kind of like progressed over the last 50 years. And it wasn't the case before. I think
the current regime has been the worst.
Yeah, it reflected the morals of the regime, and that's how people became corrupted. And I hear stories from family and older people, friends or even relatives, that it wasn't the case once before. You had to jump all the hoops to do what the law is requiring.
Oh, we have someone joining us with a question. That's wonderful.
Sure,
okay,
sure.
If you don't mind, you can see the question on the screen. Hi, Erica. Wonderful. Oh, she's wishing you happy birthday.
Thank you, Erica.
How did you learn about the NCRP program? Oh, my goodness, Erica. This is a huge question that we are going to be working up to. Because contributing to peace building in a war-torn country is a very long-term endeavor, and it's very tricky. If you don't mind staying with us, I will let Manny answer how he learned about our program. But I promise we are going to be working up to, because a diaspora community, especially during war. People from that country who are living around the world are relatively safe, more protected. They can do a great deal to contribute. But I'm going to go back to Manny before he responds to your question. Given Russia's support of the current regime, I'll tell you, years ago when I was working with Rotary International, I met some very courageous Russian lawyers, because the corruption of Russia is mafia, mob-like. It's very much a criminal state. I think we should start naming certain countries for what they are. I have Russian neighbors. I have a neighbor who was a doctor in Russia before he and his wife came here, and he will absolutely tell you the truth about what's going on in Russia. And I don't know if these lawyers are still alive, because the risks that happen to people who attempt to take on that regime. So sad to see that the regime you say is the most corrupt, you know, was then supported by this criminal state. Very, very sad.
Yeah, so Russia, 2 weeks ago, used their ninth veto against any in the UN Security Council.
Yeah, no, I'm aware, yes.
Just
I
not
don't believe
to
they
criminalize,
should be part of.
The regime in Damascus. So they're in full support on all levels, militarily and diplomatically.
Oh, yes.
So, yes.
And in terms of ruthlessly treating citizens of a country. Now, I am just now publishing a law review article that I want you and your community to see, because I do not believe the UN Security Council should just continue to have the victors from World War II. I mean, that's basically the largest military-industrial complexes of the world, especially two communist regimes. I'm not anti-communism in its ideal form, but I'm anti-communism when it's criminal thugs who are killing journalists and other people who speak the truth. And so I'm writing, actually, if you look at the criteria for UN Security Council membership, Brazil and India have been advocating for it for a long time. It's time we ask Russia to stop. I mean, look, we see what happens when we have the current membership. It's a cost to the whole world.
I see the current mechanism of the UN Security Council does not allow the alienation of Russia from decision
making. No, I'm aware.
So it is really... We need to reform to the...
We need to reform our international systems, yes.
And I think the U.S. just pulled out of UNESCO just recently, maybe last month. And this is an indication that the U.S. It may be not a wise decision to make, but...
No, probably a short term. Hopefully when this presidency is over, it will... Yeah.
But this is like a kind of a sign that we're not happy with the current system, with the current mechanism of the organization, the UN organization as a whole, in general.
Well, now I do critique the UN quite a bit in my article, too. That's a whole other conversation. We have another student joining us. Jeremy, good to see you. I still haven't given Manny a chance to say how he discovered our program. I will in a moment. But I know you've been in the U.S. for quite some time, but did you notice that your training in NCRP affected the way you perceive, accept Americans versus the way you perceive Syrians? Do you more closely identify with either or both equally? Now, that is a loaded question,
that's
Jeremy.
That's a very good question, yes.
It's excellent, and I am actually going to let Manny respond, begin to respond. We've just started our conversation here.
Yes,
okay.
So I wanted to respond to Erica. I learned about NCRP by total coincidence, and I was looking into...
I don't believe in coincidence, neither do you. That's right. Okay.
So I was looking at a business management advanced courses or program, but I came across the different programs that Dominguez Hills offered, and it was one fascinating decision I ever made. I think the most fascinating, the best decision.
Yes.
And sometimes things, again, happen for a reason. And
yes.
And that...
No, I count my life on that, actually. And you chose, when you were given an option between more advanced business education and peacebuilding, you went with peacebuilding. And
absolutely, yes.
We are a rare emerging interdisciplinary field that I think the time has come to go forward with growing what we're doing. The Quakers were the original people that said, let's have peace studies as well as military war studies. But we haven't yet advanced. And when I show you my article, there are many ways we should be advancing, studying what's actively happening on the ground with peace building as a rigorous international exercise. It would help enormously. Now, I'm really curious, after your education, did you start to perceive or accept Americans differently? Let's take one of these questions at a time, okay?
Yes.
You've lived now in the United States for 20 plus, almost 30
23 years.
23. Okay. Mm-hmm. And you lived in Houston, Texas. Now, from my experience, that would have been a different experience than Southern California.
Absolutely.
But actually, before you start to discuss, answer Jeremy's question, I want to ask what your experience has been like as an immigrant to the United States over the years. Do you mind just giving us somewhat of a history?
Sure. I think it varies greatly between where you settle.
I agree with you.
Southern California is highly diverse and accepting.
International, really.
And honestly, I feel great here in Southern California, although Orange County is considered number one
hate groups
for even the highest incidents, hate incidents against Muslims. Luckily, I haven't experienced any, nor my family. Maybe because of the fair skin, or maybe because...
Maybe ignorance of the people around you, but thank God you haven't been targeted. Did you have a different experience in Houston, Texas? It's not as diverse. I really don't know Texas.
It is not as diverse, for sure, and people are kind of really fear what they don't know. And they... All changed after 9/11. Before, I was there before 9/11,
right.
And people were more maybe accepting. But after 9/11, I think everything changed. And,
yeah, I agree.
And the sentiments in Texas, I was told, that was changed against all immigrants, not only
Texas has the border issue going on all the time, too. That I'm aware of, yes. All immigrants are an issue.
And back to Jeremy's question, I really have not, I haven't felt any change perceiving others, whether Americans or Syrians or any other individual.
Based on your NCRP education.
Yeah, it has not affected my perception of others. This is something I think you're born with and raised on accepting or not. And especially when you're introduced to other cultures at an early age, you're more open to embrace others easily than maybe coming at an older age to the U.S.
Well, now, I have no idea, but Damascus, Syria, is somewhat of a diverse city. Minority groups as well. Small minority groups. What would you say?
Can you give us a picture? Like a highly diverse country, religiously and ethnically.
Okay.
See,
I'm clueless too. And
I went to Christian school. My grandmother was Armenian Christian. Most of my friends are, and I was exposed to different cultures, different religions.
And you are a Muslim yourself.
I am
yes?
Muslim. I'm a good Muslim, and I don't necessarily reflect the community here. I'm just a random practitioner, if you will.
I would not even know how to begin to talk about the community here, because I'll tell you, I don't know if you heard my story in one of the broadcasts where I went looking for diversity in Southern California. And Jeremy, you may have heard this. I shared it with Nicholas. I moved from Malibu, which I found very, you know, and somewhat dull, you know, very, I love the beach, but there wasn't much more there. And Pepperdine is a whole conversation, that community, which I'm not going to do today. But I moved to Santa Monica in West LA, and people were saying to me, oh, this is diverse. And I discovered because they were Jewish and Christian, white Americans, they experienced that as a diverse community. But it wasn't until I moved close to the mosque of Culver City Palms, that I went and I saw the Africans, and you know, I'm like, this is the diversity I've been looking for. The international LA, rather than, you know, different separate communities of LA. Now, I have no idea what Orange County, I haven't even been to Little Arabia, but Lisa has just written in that she didn't know Orange County had so much hate crimes. Lisa, unfortunately, Jeff Sapp, who teaches in our College of Education, worked with Southern Poverty Law Center before he came to Dominguez Hills. And yes, Southern Poverty Law Center still says they lead the country. And the majority that the research I look at shows are against Jewish Americans, African Americans, and gay men. But I'm very concerned to hear that it also leads with hate crimes against the Muslim community, because I am anti-hate no matter, you know, what we're discussing. It's just wrong. It's like the opposite of NCRP and peacebuilding. She says, I live in Southern County. Oh, that's the conservative part of Orange County, I hear. I've never lived in Orange County. I happily visit regularly. The majority of people out here are mixed race, Muslim, Persian, Asians. And when you say Asians, do you mean Chinese, Japanese? I mean, that's a really big category. And East Indian. Okay, well, that answers some of the Asian. This was news to me. I'm shocked. Well, I'm glad we're waking up some of the consciousness of our students. It's definitely true, but I'm happy you never experienced it.
Yeah, the last 2 years, we've witnessed an increased number nationwide in hate crimes and incidents.
Yeah, since our current presidency, the shift.
And this is something we have to address clearly, because this is affecting all of us. This is affecting
especially our children.
And this will, at one point, will backfire on us. So this is...
It could destroy the country, depending on the directions we go.
Yeah, the last time I looked, there were 316 registered incidents in Orange County, anti-Muslim hate crime or anti-hate incidents.
That is, wow.
Versus 125 from 2 years before. So there's like a drastic
increase. More than doubled. And were you able to learn any of the details? Were religious places of worship attacked? Were individuals attacked?
I think mostly were individual attacks.
Oh dear.
And this is more bothering, I think. And it's not targeted to a specific place, but to certain people. Many people don't show that they're Muslims, obviously, because maybe I'm one of them that if you see me in the...
Right. So it's people who are wearing more traditional clothing. Now, I'll tell you, one of my embarrassments as an American is how often the Sikh community of India, who the traditional Sikhs wear turbans, are attacked as Muslims, and they're not. I'm like, Americans need to educate themselves in so many ways. So you think you're able to blend in, but somebody who stands out gets attacked?
And just like you gave an example about even someone that looked like a Middle
Someone's
Eastern.
Stereotype of, yes.
And the majority of the population, just Lisa mentioned, that they're from different parts of the world, that not necessarily white, that kind of the one considered the offender in most cases, against minorities in general?
Well, no, actually, the committers of hate crime, that's what you're talking about? No, they're not always white.
They're not always, but I'm saying that maybe the majority is.
No, we have a diverse group of haters in this country, and it saddens me, and I don't want to go into that conversation. But the point you made, that we're raised to either be multicultural, open, accepting of people, or we're not, is true all around the world when it comes to the people who are most violent and mistreat other people.
Well, the reason I say that, because when Lisa numbered the different groups or different countries where the most of the population is from.
Oh, that's true.
That's probably was an indication that it's not all white dominant community.
It's not. So she described it well. Yes.
Yeah, so it's that doesn't exclude the offenders and from being the majority of some group.
No, you and I are saying the same thing, and I may have misunderstood. Yes. No, some of our most conservative segregated groups are actually immigrants to this country as well, and we need to have a dialogue, everyone. Okay, now we have answered the now, asking whether you identify, I've never even had the conversation, whether you're a U.S. citizen, whether your family are U.S. citizen.
I am a proud Syrian American.
Yes, yeah, very good. Thank you. Yeah. I'm like, wow, Jeremy jumped right to one of those questions. And I do understand some of the complexities for people, depending on family around the world. Fortunately for my sister, who fell in love with an Irishman, her children and herself, they're able to have dual citizenship, and she's still able to vote in the United States. That's very, very important to her. But some countries insist that you pick, you know, the country, and that can be very tough. Lisa is back with us. I think the younger generation is much more accepting than the older generation. My children grew up here. Okay, Lisa, thank you. And we are Mexican, and we haven't met yet, Lisa. I don't know if you're recent immigrants to the country or if you've lived here even before California became a state, but they have friends with all different races. I think it is the older generations, not the younger. I am in, how do you pronounce this?
Liso Viejo.
Thank you, yes. Okay, thank you for the information. Do you identify more as a Syrian American? How do you do that? Jeremy was asking.
Yeah, I decided when I moved to America 23 years ago, I decided that this is my home country that I wanted to be in.
Yes.
And based on that, I had to embrace all values and all what this country is about.
Tell me more. That is one of the earlier comments you made. It's not just economic opportunity. What else do you see from your experience as a...
Like, I appreciate diversity. I appreciate the opportunity on all levels. And the main thing I appreciate in reality is freedom. The freedom even of practicing my religion that was probably a little... it is available, of course, to the mainstream. But if you wanted to be to practice your, you can't practice it freely. And that's what I was trying to say.
You can't practice your Muslim faith, Islam, freely.
You can, but there is like a stigma attached to whoever is practicing Islam. It's not like as open as here. It's just kind of reserved to certain backgrounds and maybe certain age groups. Like you're practicing if you're over a certain age, maybe 50, 60 or whatever.
Right, sure.
And that's when people kind of return back to maybe accept the reality of their mortality.
Yes, and they're looking for spirituality, faith. Okay.
There's like a stigma attached to that. But here, I think there's more acceptance, more to all religions. And I have not experienced anything bad in practicing Islam here. It was all a positive experience, whether it was here in Southern California or even in Texas back then when it was kind of like a conservative community, if you will, conservative Christian community in general.
Oh, yes, I would imagine the evangelical Christian
and
community.
I totally agree with Lisa that newer generation is more accepting of others because we were raised maybe not exposed to all races or all ethnicities or backgrounds, especially if you're in a country that doesn't have diversity.
The international diversity.
One of the diversity aspects that I really appreciate here, being exposed to the Latino culture or to the Asian culture that I highly, highly appreciate and
Here's Lisa telling us India and Korea, Vietnam, Chinese. Yes, those are all rich cultures, aren't they?
I highly regard those cultures, and I learned a lot from them. I enjoy their cuisine, and these are the things that you don't see combined in one place. Those cultures, those subcultures, subgroups are here around me, and I get to enjoy them and experience their culture in one place.
Yes,
and
I know, I love it too.
Yeah, you can only find this in Southern California, and I'm lucky to be in Orange County to have all those groups or cultures.
Well, you know, LA County has all those groups, cultures too. The difference, I think, Orange County, and I am the grandchild of immigrants to this country from Norway. I didn't mention the later immigrants to this country, but I know what it's like to be a child, a grandchild of relatively recent immigrants. I needed to get the best grades in school. I needed to excel, succeed. Very important. And I see that in Orange County with the immigrant families. They take great pride in their children's success. They want their children to have prosperous futures. And you see it, you know. And we also, sadly, we have stereotypical explanations for some of that success. But in my experience, also as a faculty of the children, the young people of those families, they're growing up the way I grew up. You know, I wish all American children had some of that pressure, some of that family pride, you know, that vision of prosperity. So good, I'm glad you are one of my guests who enjoys what I enjoy. Now, the other half of Jeremy's question actually piggybacks with Erica's earlier question. After being a part of our program, you started to notice how you had seen Syrians doing what they were trying to do to build peace. Yeah, so some of your perceptions changed in that if only you now had language to say, oh, they were trying to build peace. They were trying to speak truth to power, catalyze justice for all human beings. This is what people were trying to do. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes, so it's still an ongoing war.
Haven't gotten to the... Yes, very much, sadly.
Yes, there is a negotiation table now, but it's not advancing. Sadly, it's not advancing.
No, they need a mediator who's masterful, really. They do. Because usually it's a distributive bargaining situation that they're attempting to do, the people at the table. Because that's how most men think, frankly, around the world. You have to compromise. And the male ego is not about compromise. That is across culture. Mediators are able to help people save face, you know, find ways to reach agreement. But once again, with someone with the bad faith of Russia in there and the regime, as you're educating me about the current regime, you can't have any kind of negotiation.
Yeah, and also back to the topic of this program.
Peace building,
That it is inconceivable to envision sustainable peace in Syria without restorative justice. And if we can bring those war criminals to the criminal court, it is really not a feasible a truce, because it's going to be like it's going to be really for a short period of time, and it's going to erupt back again, unless we see radical change in the other side, which is the regime side.
Well, without international pressure, I mean, it wouldn't have gone on as long as it had if international pressure was able to budge that. But I'll say something, because I was the Nansen Network of Norway asked me to help them facilitate cross-ethnic dialogue during the Balkans War. So I have actively worked during a war with people from, now we're just discussing one country here, but the Balkans, from several countries who really wanted peace and wanted to get oust, you know, their ruthless, you know, the leader who created that war. They were not crushed the way that Syrian people have been crushed the last 6 years. You need to have a critical mass, even the diaspora, you know, around the world. What I'm envisioning is the healing, the cultural transitioning of all these refugee families. There's just so much on the plate, it's hard to envision.
Yes, and just to give you a couple of numbers on the magnitude of the crisis in Syria.
Yes.
So the population before the war was around 22 million. So the number of displaced and refugees now is over 13 million. So that's like more than half of the population.
More than half.
In either displaced within Syria or in the neighboring countries as refugees, with Turkey being the largest host of Syrian refugees, about 3.5 million registered refugees.
Yes, I saw that research,
And you mentioned the numbers earlier on the PowerPoints on how many people were admitted into different countries like Sweden or Canada.
Right.
And I think Germany hosts over 600,000.
Germany leads the list.
Absolutely. So, the last official number in the U.S. was 16,000 admitted Syrian refugee, to the U.S. in general.
Okay.
But I tell you, there is a lot more that came to the U.S. and asked for asylum. They came to the U.S. on a tourist visa, and this is the largest number that it is changing, I think, the landscape of the community in Orange County and in Southern California in general. And the reason why people came to Southern California, because of the already established community here.
They will go to whatever community they know.
Exactly.
They know will support
them. Older folks joined their sons and daughters, and younger families came here because they think it's more diverse and they're more accepting. And I think the school system here in Southern California in general, and in particular in Orange County, did an excellent job in accommodating those Syrian refugees.
Oh, that's good to hear. We have another student. Okay. Crystal, good to see you. I'm glad you were able to join us. Crystal is asking, what cultural religious factors of the Syrian people do you believe have played a part in their strength, resiliency, and courage in the face of war? Well, that's...
So the conflict in Syria started not a religious conflict, obviously.
Political oppression,
oppressed people against the regime.
They were just fed up, 50 years of being oppressed with increasing corruption.
Exactly.
And trying to answer some of Crystal's question, yes.
Yes, and but then when Iran got involved with the war in Syria and contributed greatly.
I remember.
And fueled the religious differences in Syria. So it turned...
Well, this is some of the manipulation that goes on. I have watched over my years of teaching peace building, and the anthropologists of war back this up, that people will manipulate, the media will manipulate and create a narrative that is actually not true if you know the people on the ground. If you're working with the people closely, it's propaganda that the whole world is believing, like this is religious or this is ethnic, and it's absolutely not true. People have been living together, you know, they may be oppressed together, whatever, but they it did not fuel for religious reasons. But now everybody that I talk to thinks it's religious.
There is a big religious part. It's still political, obviously, and oppression.
Yes. How does religion affect it?
Religion was religious differences was or were fueled by outside interference, like
yes, like Iran. Yes,
Iran in particular. There's no other country for that, and other sects or other sub. Categories of Islam, we didn't know that they existed in Syria until that interference happened by Iran.
Okay.
So we didn't know about the differences until that...
more radicalized sects? Or what? Tell us, give us an image
it's,
of
it's
the sect.
Mostly now it is Shiites and Sunni and Alawites, which is the where the regime is mostly consist of, which is a minority in the majority Sunni country,
right,
which is
right,
Syria.
Yes.
So there is a bigger plot I think Iran is trying to probably achieve in the region. And
yes.
They created some problems in Lebanon, Syria, greatly in Syria and Yemen and
yeah,
Bahrain.
Yeah, no, you see this, that's right, over the time with the Middle East.
Yeah, and we also witnessed some radicals arriving from Arabia, from Saudi.
I was going to ask you about Saudi Arabia,
yeah,
yes.
So these outside forces and outside the financial a contribution to fuel the war in Syria. They're still acting actively, and that's causing the war to continue. Otherwise, the regime doesn't have the resources.
There's no way.
To
so this is not just about Syria and the Syrian people. It's about the Middle East and some of the other agendas of some of the other countries in the Middle East, and.
Absolutely. There are so many, it started obviously people and regime, but then I can't tell you the number of parties involved in the war in Syria. That's why it is a complex conflict, and it's not easy to find a solution to say that if we do this, that we're going to
Well, there will never, you know, I really believe, like the Balkans, here's what happened with the Balkans. People were doing dialogue, trying to figure out what might help this situation, but there were parallel tracks of people that were building nonviolent, you know, like Arab Spring, the nonviolent movement. People who were attempting, you know, if you know the history with Gandhi and nonviolence, to align with some of the international players who could be supporting what is needed. And I just, frankly, as an American, watching the propaganda I see in the media sometimes, think this, we have bungled this and made it, you know, worse so many. I'm not just talking about Syria, I'm talking about Iraq and Afghanistan and being cozy with Saudi Arabia during the Bush administration as they're funding, you know, terrorists against us. So we just keep getting it wrong. But instead of going there with you, Erica was asking about, and here's what I was about to say, it needs to be incremental. It needs to be built over time. Mm-hmm. It's not a solution. You know, that's how people at negotiation tables talk. They're going to fix it. They're going to solve it. No. You know, maybe they can agree to a ceasefire, but the actual steps that need to be taken, let's focus on the best of the Syrian people you know, either here or around the world, how the world, how viewers might be trying to help them build lives so that they're capable of being part of this kind of conversation. Okay, Crystal, your explanation of corruption dictatorship in Syria sounds eerily similar to the current situation in Cambodia, Venezuela. Oh, and Crystal, I studied Jimmy Carter's mediation and his work in Venezuela when I was in Brazil. This should be interesting. Knowing what you know now, what advice would you give to those? And now this is going, might be a stretch. Manny and I can answer together. Crystal, we actually have an alumni who has lived and worked in Cambodia, who currently works for Save the Children. So I hope maybe you can get on Facebook with Manny and I can introduce you to Christy Adams. There's a lot to answer with these kind of questions. What advice would you give to those in Cambodia, Venezuela, who fear the future under their current regime? With so many refugees being relocated to various countries throughout the world, how do you feel we can best help these displaced people adapt and safely assimilate to their new home? Well, Crystal, actually, you're now in sync with my question to Manny. That works. Okay.
So Syrians are known to be highly educated, and they blend in and accommodate and embrace new cultures easily.
So good to hear.
I don't see a big need for Syrians or Syrian refugees or immigrants to embrace or to be a part of the society or culture here. This is not of...
They're already figuring that out for themselves while they're here. Yes,
exactly. And I think there's a great sense of comprehension of their problem, of the problem of the Syrian immigrants or refugees, and I think most people are keen to help in any
help
way.
Help each other.
Help each other, and not necessarily financially, and mostly support. I say take a minute to learn about the community, about the Syrian crisis. Just get a few numbers off the internet and you'll know the magnitude of the devastation of the people.
Yes.
And then you can reach out to the community and see how you can help.
Or, around you, get to know people.
And if you needed any help, please contact me directly.
Okay.
And
wonderful.
We can do so many things together. And again, it's not financial support of any sort or shape, because some of the things you can actually buy. I mean, you should be having friends or having support in
the
community.
Right, compassion, understanding, yes.
These are things.
Faith, all of it, yes.
Yeah, so with that being said, I think there is a little need for intercultural understanding between Syrians and the new environment they're in. I think there's more room for interfaith, because religion is here to stay, but maybe you can easily, again, embrace or be part of the new culture. And that's something, again, Syrians are very well doing.
Prepared to. Well, and I don't have enough time on this show really to explore all the possibilities with interfaith dialogue and all, but I would love to learn more. I have met with the Interfaith Council of LA and seen the religious leaders who are attempting to build community across, you know, multi-faith communities in Southern California. I would love to learn more about that. Now, I think I was starting to answer the first half of Crystal's question when I talked about Gandhi and nonviolence with oppressive, repressive regimes. There's actually a book that, if I ever teach a course totally on nonviolent peacebuilding for NCRP, and I would love to someday, there is a book studying the transitions from repressive authoritarian regimes to democracy. And nonviolence is much more successful than violent conflict war, but most human beings don't know how to wage a successful nonviolent campaign. It's like leading a military troop. It's extraordinarily complicated. I do think we saw a shining example with some of what happened in Egypt, you know, Tunisia. We did see some of the best, but the Balkans, that was a parallel track that was happening to get rid of Milosevic and to prosecute some of the war crimes. And, you know, I currently have a Brazilian student in Sweden who is asking me what NGOs are working in the Middle East where he could learn, as a Brazilian man, how to help the Middle East with peace building. And I frankly, from what I've seen, the levels of corruption where I visited, do not have NGOs to recommend to him. I mean, we need very savvy politicians, several countries that are reshaping our international system, quite committed to prosecuting war crimes, you know, making war something that costs rather than profits. So do you know of NGOs that are doing
work? I think it's really early in the Syria situation to have an NGO interfere, especially not a player in the ongoing war.
Not
now.
The war, no.
But there is definitely a need for a criminal for criminals to go to courts at one point, to at least for Syrians to restore their faith in humanity, because the international community gave up on the Syrian people for 7 years.
And
And it's not 1970 or before, where you have limited access to media. Everything is documented.
Right. It's been horrible.
And everybody is watching, and we're still only watching. And the international community still don't
it's
have
like
the will.
It's like they're paralyzed.
Yeah, don't have the will yet to solve the Syrian issue. And once there is a will one day, and this will happen eventually, 2 years, 50 years, 200 years from now, it's going to happen one day. It's not, the war will end, and people will go back to normal. And but people wanted to see at least some of the justice that's served one point, that some of those war criminals been prosecuted. And it's not going to be all criminals, because it's a massive work to do, but at least like the symbols of those crimes to be prosecuted.
At least someone, yes. So someone, they see some justice, yes. And a message is given to the world.
Right, but for NGOs, it's a little primitive now to say that.
I would agree with you.
Maybe in the long future, and this is something I'm working on in the peace building arena, I'm putting together a foundation to help. To empower and educate Syrian youth to embrace democracy and leadership to help rebuild the future Syria.
Well, that will be the task, the rebuilding of the country, of the culture.
But this is a long,
very long-term investment.
Long process. Yeah, yes. What happened is over the 50 years, the past 50 years, the regime in Damascus eradicated all possible threats and any endeavor to democracy or any leadership. So there's a vacuum that it needs to be filled at one point. And that's one of the reasons why the current opposition failed miserably in representing the Syrian people, because they don't have the experience, or they don't have the...
they don't even have the capacity.
They don't have the
do
capacity
what's
to
needed to build a democracy.
So maybe in the next generation or two or whatever, that this will be filled properly. And this is something I'm working on to help to clarify that Syrian youth in the diaspora, not in Syria. So it's mainly here around us.
Yes, no, it's a wonderful vision, and it's actually something to bring hope to the youth for creating the future, and to help them feel like they can play a part in building that future.
They can be capable of taking the leadership in leading the country at one point, because the first generation and second generation more and more get disconnected from their home country, and now this is because of the new communications and social media, people get more connected.
Arab Spring. That was amazing to watch.
Yeah, can contribute more in in all aspects of rebuilding a country, or at least helping partially in doing so.
And now I'll share a couple of things. One is one of the things I'm recommending in my law review article, which I just submitted this morning for publication this month, is that Norway historically has been the trusted mediating nation, but drop the ball. I mean, Broadway is now celebrating the failed Oslo Accords. I mean, I've studied some of the reasons that Norway did not succeed, as well as why Jimmy Carter did not succeed in Venezuela. And this is part of why I'm saying we need to really create long-term research, applied research, on-the-ground case studies of what people are doing in particular situations to move it forward. But the good news is, because, you know, you look at a military giant like India, you know, pick the emerging country democracy, they're not going to be a trusted mediator by anyone. They're going to be seen as self-interest first. And Brazil is similar with agriculture and business, self-interest first. But if you get these smaller trusted nation states that have very affluent lifestyles, are concerned about the situation, like Germany and Sweden, they are showing interest, actually. I think Sweden might be one of the countries, Finland definitely is, of joining Norway in being trusted mediating states. Now, I'm saying they need to get in there and help with reformulating our whole international system. Because the UN, with its corruption and with its propensity, as well as, you know, these countries, I've been to the countries, I know how often they spend that money not on their own youth, but on the Harvard experts, you know, the Hollywood celebrity, somebody who can fly in and get them press and doesn't do a thing for the people. That's where the money has gone. If we get enough of a group that says we're going to start to monitor this, because the other thing is the Middle East, I've seen where the development aid has gone. Israel, Palestine, so many people, so many countries have thrown money at that conflict without overseeing how is that money being spent. Is it helping the people? Is it hurting? It is really disgusting to see the laziness of the people who've dumped money on these conflicts. But the other thing, Crystal, you know, the mediators and the negotiators who are currently involved in some of these world crises, Jimmy Carter, for all I adore him as a human being, he does not know how to mediate. He has never studied NCRP. He would sit at the table with the president and the opposition leaders, listen to their complaints, and that's all he did. He tried to tell the president what to do to appease the people, but he never said, let's invite their representatives here. Let's, you know, let's reframe some of this. Let's explore what we can do in the country. And I'm not saying we can do this in Syria during the war. I'm trying to respond to some of her questions. I totally agree with you. This is a long-term endeavor, but we need to do what we can to get these systems in place and ensure that people at the table aren't just doing what they do with a car sale purchase or real estate. I mean, there's so much more they can be learning to help move these processes forward.
Right. I think there was a question about what advice to give to people of Venezuela or other countries.
Cambodia. Who have oppressive governments. And I responded with nonviolence and that we need more of this skill, mastery, international systems.
Right. There is no one fix
no,
fits
that's
all.
What peace building is, systems analysis.
Yeah, so it's each conflict is unique on
yes.
its own. And one scenario in Syria cannot be applied to Venezuela or Cambodia or any other country because it is unique to that conflict. And I think it is not, we don't have cookie cutter module to apply to other conflicts. And that's the reason why we're here.
Well, no, but you hear what I'm saying. We do have actually nonviolence campaigns. We have hundreds of years of case studies where people around the world have organized and effectively strategized resistance against repressive regimes. And we also have these skills and processes that could help empower all the parties if we could spread some of the education of peace building. But then, there's no cookie cutter. This isn't like a corporate training where, you know, I've always found that offensive. They give you the 7 points to understand the Middle East. Sure. No, we are talking about real world peace building, and it's very complex. It takes a lot of sustained effort. Is there anything else? I think we have, I don't know how much time we have left, actually. Maybe the broadcasting studio can help us with that, but I think we have a little bit of time. We've covered quite a range of topics. I'm so happy to hear you've had a very positive experience in the U.S. I also believe freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of association, freedom of everything. I mean, that is the best. Equal protection under the law. You know, even though I'm a woman, formerly, you know, a piece of property in the United States, I now have the right to vote. I have the right to do whatever I want in my life. All of that to me is so worth saving and preserving as we're going through our current ugly times politically. I'll tell you, the corruption in the U.S. is political campaign financing, funding. The fact we've allowed corporations and extremely wealthy people to fund the campaigns of our representatives in D.C., it has totally corrupted that system. But the other place where we have corruption that is really disturbing is our healthcare system. Pharmaceutical companies, doctors, there's a lot of corruption in our, and that was never true when I was a young girl in this country. So it's a bit like Syria. The wealth, you know, has perverted what I really love and cherish about my country. But I hear that you are joining me in trying to preserve that for everyone. Is there anything else you'd like to say in our time together?
It's a call for all of us. To touch on what you just said on corruption here, just we have great values in this country as humans and as citizens of this great country, and we've got to speak for ourselves and be bold and loud about our values and not to let extremes, religious or political extremes, speak.
Right. The haters of the U.S. Yeah.
Yeah, and the way to do that is to speak with the same pitch and the same volume as those voices on the fringes. So that's the way to combat the extreme that we're facing today, and it's not healthy for our future.
Yes, to be as strong and as loud to let people know that we disagree with these extremists who are anti all the things we cherish. Yes, that is one gift I see of our current presidency. I'm seeing the emergence of more and more voices, more and more people say, no, we don't agree with this. This is not the world we want to live in. This is not our country. And I must say, I have said this on the show before, California is a real leader in the United States, and I am very proud and grateful. I feel blessed that I get to live in this state for a number of different reasons. And one of the challenges I face, actually, is trying to help former President Obama. Right now, he's trying to help because the rearranging of districts to preference the most conservative, the most extremist of voice is part of the challenge we face as a country. But I live in California, you know, where basically life is good most of the time. Edward, I'm happy you're joining us. We do have a few more minutes. Do you think the media plays a part in manipulating the stance on certain wars, like the war on terrorism? And if so, how can we avoid being misled? Wonderful question. Wow. Do you want to take, Ioana?
I think social media, especially social media, not only the media, but in particular social media, played a great, made a big impact on the Arab Spring. And
it can be a force for very positive organizing, yes.
It is, and but it failed the people of Syria. People thought in Syria that this is going to be a, again, seamless transition.
Right.
And so media can mislead people even for a good cause.
Oh, even when they're seeing something that gives them hope, that inspires them. I agree. They saw what was happening in Egypt. Yes, Arab Spring. And, yes.
And it was fueled by all other media outlets in the region, and now that media outlets in the region are being oppressed, and just
right.
Yesterday the in Saudi they kind of booked the three owners of the main media outlets in the Middle East, companies or corporations, and for alleged corruption
yes,
scheme.
No, we've had some of that here too with
so,
media.
Media can lead to different ways, whether like, especially in fighting terrorism. This is, we shouldn't take it at face value. This is a simple
right,
way.
Right, we need to educate ourselves.
We need to
ourselves.
Investigate a little more,
yes.
And,
yes.
And research. And there are all kind of tools to research and get the right answers. Yes, it is led for political reasons. Media is,
well,
of
it can be. Now, here's what happened in this country under the Bush administration, because I wondered about the propaganda with the Middle East. And I asked some of my students who were working for the major stations what was going on. Well, we're becoming a little political, but I don't mind. We're all, you know, aware of American politics. What I was told is Republican owners took over our major media stations before and during the Bush administration. So it was political. It was propaganda. Now, as a lawyer, I look more at our legal system, and I think Americans have been seeing under the current presidency that we've got some truly independent, non-political lawyers. No matter what their party affiliation, they take pride in being independent. That's part of the checks and balances of our democracy. But when a certain party manipulates and seizes ownership and control, like you're describing, I heard about, then it's political manipulation. And I would say the other thing, besides investigating, determining, there's all sorts of sources of news right now. Social media, BBC, go around the world. Find your trusted sources of news. That's something every adult should do, is find who they trust the most. So that's what's feeding them, rather than allowing just anybody to dump in. That's very important.
It is a little difficult to find one source. That
not
don't
just one.
One or two valid sources. Because there's
yeah.
a few that needs to be examined all the time. Checks and balances.
Yes.
And because sometimes just organizations like BBC can fail. And because at one point BBC supported the regime in Damascus for
really?
Quite, yeah.
I didn't even know
so
that.
So sometimes they're not
always. I think multiple sources. No, I would never depend on one. I totally agree with you here. I think they're getting an image of what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. The other thing, the war on terrorism, I think, you know, Edward, nobody wants to tune into media that, well, like my conversation right now with Manny about Syria. They tend to want to tune in when somebody's getting murdered, shot, you know, there's some kind of sex scandal, whatever. It's very exciting. But the whole, the war on terrorism, if we would have a course on terrorism, which Gus Martin does have at Dominguez Hills, but if we would also have a course on the war, would need to include all the wars, you know, and how this has been created over a lifetime. And I think it would also need to include the how men are doing around the world, how they're being raised around the world, and how many of them truly are isolated, lonely. You know, there's this whole phenomena going on with lone wolf American males who will never go to the Middle East, but they are very lonely, alienated, and angry. And that's a whole other discussion. I've been concerned about the suicide of young males in the U.S. for a long time. So whatever we're being asked, there's a lot to say.
Yes, I think we have to be careful using the word terrorism, and we have to not to label everything.
Well, I agree with you on that. There's a particular definition that most academics agree to.
Well, and media doesn't agree with that all
the time.
Well,
no, media is not what I would be watching on this.
Yeah,
yes.
Because they can label anything as terrorist or terrorism or
war
on terrorism.
And even that, silly things that...
And large part of the ongoing war in Syria is because of the war on terrorism. They're fighting terrorists, and that's what the... official.
Label anyone in a war as a terrorist. No. Yes, you know, since I have Irish family, we could talk about terrorism for a while. But what I'm going to recommend, because we don't have a lot of time, Gus Martin has had a show on terrorism. He is recognized globally for seriously studying this to take away all the paranoia, you know, all of the false information, and to talk about what countries need to do to protect themselves. And he does not include, countries at war. That is a risk that can take place often, but it's a totally different discussion.
And I think it is safe to mention that most terrorist attacks happen in Muslim countries, and the people who are defending her raging war against terrorism are Muslims themselves. So
I don't know if that's necessarily true. That's interesting. I lived here with the Oklahoma City bombing.
Yeah, Timothy McVeigh is a good example of not being labeled as terrorist, although...
But it was terrorism, yeah. Given how terrorism truly is defined. The abortion clinic bombings, too, that fits within the definition
of
terrorism.
Even the recent Las Vegas incident was not labeled as terrorist.
It was terrorism?
It could be labeled from a different faith, it could have been labeled as terrorist.
Well, no, the definition that I know is about non-political groups, so groups who have not been, you know, elected. I'm talking from a democracy. I'm not talking from a dictatorship, but... who are using violence for political ends. So it rarely brings in faith, identity. That is not part of the discussion. Now, Northern Ireland was, you know, the classic terrorist situation because they were politically using violence within the UK because of oppression of Irish people within Northern Ireland, not the Republic of Ireland. And we don't have time to go through this, but if Gus Martin does his show again, maybe we could be guests or be part of this really important discussion. I think our bottom line is it's important to educate yourself, because there's a lot that goes on in this world that is uneducated. But I was giving you a few minutes to say whatever else you wanted to say.
The time to learn about your surrounding, the other communities, whether Syrian or other communities. Maybe Syrian community is smaller than other communities, but I felt really enriched being exposed to other cultures here. And I urge you to take the opportunity to be introduced to other cultures.
Yeah, as many as you can.
And that's how you break the fear, because that's what's preventing you from interacting with others and thriving. And we need human relation to thrive.
Yes.
And the only way to do it is by taking the initiative and being part of other communities by contributing in any form or shape, or being at least just having a conversation with others, just to know your surrounding. Here we're in rich and diverse social setting, when we should take advantage of that.
We're like the globe is here in Southern California. We really don't have to travel to enjoy and benefit so much from our diversity. So actually, I think I started this show on a similar note. I love that that's what you want to say.
Yeah, I tell you,
students.
I traveled the world, Professor, and
yes.
I haven't seen any place like Southern California. It has...
New York City might have some similarity.
Well, with reservation to the weather...
Okay, we are paradise here.
Yeah,
so no, I do love living
here, too. It is complete of
too.
All... and I hope I maintain this image of this great place that I love.
Well, I love it here, too. Now, I will say London is a very diverse, multicultural city. New York... it's interesting to reflect on what you just said, but I still, despite, you know, needing to think about this, love living in Southern California yeah. with you. Thank you so much
you.
For being a part of our show.
Thank you for having me.
Yes. Have a wonderful birthday.
Thank you.